Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning. Welcome to our Sunday morning worship service. It is First Sunday, and I am glad to honor the Lord, worship him in spirit and in truth, hear his powerful word, and remember his death until he comes. It's Communion Sunday. It's First Sunday. Once again, I'm Bishop Eric Kim K. Clark, and welcome. We encourage you to call your family and friends. Like it, share it, follow, subscribe, hit all the buttons this morning as we prepare to worship the Lord. We're going to enter into those ministry protocols today, and we are excited. We are excited. On last Sunday, we had our first time in the Silver Spot Cinema, and here we are back again, believing God for his spirit, for his power, for his anointing. And for those of you all that are watching online, we pray the grace of God upon you as well. Do me a favor, hit all the buttons, like, share, follow, and subscribe, and gather your household together. Let's hear the word of the Lord. It is Supersede Sunday. We are prepared to worship the Lord in a very special way. On Wednesday night, we had a very powerful lesson, and we learned about the worship of preparation. Actually, preparing to worship God is presented as our worship. And we're ready. We're ready to praise him. We're ready to worship him in spirit and in truth. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you now for the Spirit of the Lord that is upon us. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for another day. Thank you for bringing us together in your name. Your word declares where we're together in your name, you are in our midst. Now smile upon us and give us favor. Come on in, Jesus. Come on into the room. Come on into the house. Come on in to wherever your people are as we have learned to minister from our location. We invite your presence. We invite your anointing that destroys the yoke. Come on in and have your way in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Hit all the buttons, like, share, follow, and subscribe. Call everyone you know, and let's worship the Lord together.
Starting me on my way. morning, starting me on my way. You put food on my table, brought joy to my day.
Hallelujah. We give him honor. We give him praise. Hallelujah. God, be God in our lives as we stand still.
What do you do when life is beating up on you and you have nowhere to turn to? Wondering if the Lord is gonna come through. And what do you say when you can't seem to find? Feels like you never see the light of day. Don't even have the energy to pray.
my God, what a powerful time of worship. Come on and lift your hands. If you're not worshiping right now, come on in. Let the Holy Spirit sit upon you. Let the Holy Spirit rest upon you. My God, let his presence permeate your room wherever you are. Invite him in with your praise. Praise and worship summons the presence of the Lord. He is here right now. He's here to heal. He's here to touch. The Lord is here. He is present. And he wants to bless you right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we give you praise, glory, and honor. Oh, praise God. Well, here we are. Welcome again to our first Sunday service. And we like to take this time to honor the Lord in communion. That's right. We want to honor the Lord in the Last Supper. He gave us his instructions. He certainly told us to do this in remembrance of him. If you're at home or if you're live in the room with us, we want to make sure that you are prepared as we right now begin to allow ourselves to remember the very, very painful suffering and death that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ gave, presented to the Father on our behalf. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. By his stripes, we are healed. He that knew no sin, he became sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God by Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father, for the nails in your hands. Thank you, Father, for the crown of thorns upon your brow. Thank you for allowing them to pluck out your beard, to smack you, to beat you, to spit upon you, to shame you. And they cast lots for your garments. Father, we remember. We remember that everyone forsook you. We remember that you stood alone. We remember that you said, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." We remember. We remember you said, "My God, why hast thou forsaken me?" We remember. The precious cross, the precious blood, your suffering. You gave your life as a ransom for many. Yes, Lord, you were our propitiation. It is your death that appeased the wrath of God. And today we remember. In this moment, for those that are in the room and those that are in your home, if you would gather the elements, the bread, the cracker, the wafer that represents the body of Christ. His body was broken for us. And we are the body of Christ. The Bible says that as we receive this communion, that we should consider ourselves by releasing all of those who have trespassed against us, asking the Lord to forgive us based on how we've extended forgiveness to our brothers and sisters. Today, I stand before the Lord without harboring bitterness, hatred, unforgiveness in my heart, because God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven me, and therefore I forgive my brothers. Father, cleanse our hearts and purify our minds now. We release brothers and sisters that have trespassed against us. We ask that you would allow your blood to be applied to us. Today, we seek your forgiveness, and therefore we offer forgiveness to all of our brothers and sisters in Jesus' name. And this, Father, bread, this wafer, this cracker that represents your body that was broken for us, we do this in remembrance of you. Let's receive the Lord's body together. Thank you, Jesus. And he took the cup of suffering, the cup of his blood, What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. One of my favorite songs. It reaches to the highest mountain and flows to the lowest valley. The blood that Jesus shed on Calvary, it'll never lose its power. How are we made righteous? How are we reconciled to God? How have we been purchased? By the precious blood of Jesus. We do this in remembrance of you. Let's receive his blood together. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody lift your hands and give him thanks. Thank you, Lord, for your death, your burial, and your resurrection. Thank you. And today we remember. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Those that can, stand on your feet right where you are. Those that will, come on, stand up before the Lord. Let's present ourselves to hear his powerful word, even in your home. Let's stand to honor his powerful word. Today's reading will come from Joshua chapter 6, verse 18, 19, and verse number 24. Verse 18, verse 19, and verse number 24. Joshua chapter 6, and it reads, "As for you, keep yourselves from that which is dedicated for destruction, lest ye be destroyed. If you take from that which is dedicated for destruction, you will set the Israelite camp for destruction and bring trouble upon it. All the silver, gold, and bronze, and iron articles are set apart for the Lord. They will go into the treasury of the Lord." Verse number 24. "They burned the city and everything in it with fire. Only the silver, the gold, the bronze, and iron articles they gave to the treasury of the house of the Lord." They burned everything in the city of Jericho, but they kept the silver, the gold, the bronze, and the iron articles, and they gave them, they presented them to the treasury of the house of the Lord. For our subject matter, those that are watching online, type it in, the Lord's portion. I want to minister to you on today about the Lord's portion. Father, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. My prayer is that you will remove the thorny ground, the stony ground, and the wayside ground, and let our hearts be good ground and bring forth much fruit is my prayer. In Jesus' name, may all God's people say amen. Amen. God bless you. The Lord's portion. Look at the person next to you and tell them the Lord's portion. If you can type it in, make sure you type it in. The Lord's portion. Our initial text on this morning out of the book of Joshua chapter 6 gives us the account of the historic battle of Jericho. It was Joshua that took over for Moses, and he, amen, crosses over the Jordan and comes into the promised land. And God said, "I've given you the land." And here it is, Joshua's job was to conquer the land city by city by city. And that's exactly what Joshua did. If you ever read through the book of Joshua, you will find no less than 20, amen, 7 or 29 different cities and victories that Joshua conquered. And there were several of them that Joshua even conquered at one time. He was a fierce warrior. He was a mighty warrior. But one of the standout victories is without a doubt the city of Jericho. Here in Joshua chapter 6, it says that when they got to Jericho, the city was walled, high walls. It was straightly shut up. Nobody could get in. No one can get out. And the Bible tells us that they had sent spies ahead to spy out the city. And the woman Rahab help those spies. And so the word of the Lord came unto them and said, all right, you're going to conquer the city by marching around the walls. You don't need to say nothing. Blow the trumpets every day. And on the last day, shout, 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 blow the trumpets. And the Bible says that the walls fell down. Israel was commanded to run into the city and to set it on fire. Everyone was to be under the judgment of God, with the exception of Rahab and her family. The Bible tells us that after the city had been burned and set on fire, the city was conquered. But because this was the first city, the first of many cities that they would come into in their inheritance in Canaan land, in the promised land, God says, the first city belongs to me. The gold, the silver, the bronze, the iron, the precious stones, all of those things that would be considered treasure, spoil, valuables, God said, that's my portion. Now listen to me, Israel. I brought you out. I brought you out of Egypt. Listen, Israel, I literally sent plagues down upon the Egyptians. I drowned Pharaoh and his army in the Red Sea. I got for you, amen, quails and manna. I got for you water out of a rock. I shielded you from the hot sun, my God, by a cloud in the form of a pillar over your head by day and a fiery pillar at night to warm you. I have been your source of provision. I have protected you. I have fought for you on every side, Israel, my God. When Moses' hands were up, you won the battle. When Moses' hands were down, you lost the battle. Even when you came upon snakes and serpents and they bit you, I caused my man to raise up a serpent, and those that looked to the serpent were healed. God was saying to the people, everything that I promised, I've done. It's been water, it's been food, it's been protection, it's been shelter, it's been my, amen to God, victory in battle and warfare. God said, I've been doing everything I said I would do. And even when Joshua got to the brink of the Jordan and the Jordan overflowed its banks, you couldn't cross, but by faith, I told you to step out. Go on and step into that Jordan River. And as the priests went in, the waters began to dry up. And God told them to pick 12 stones up out of the center of the river of Jordan and stack them one upon another for a memorial. Look at all that the Lord had done. Look at what the Lord promised. And he was not slack concerning his promise. He not only brought them out of Egypt, he brought them through the wilderness and now into the promised land. And now that they were into the promised land, the Lord says, I'm going to bless you. It will be a land flowing with milk and honey. Yes, I'm going to give you the heathen, amen, for your inheritance. You will have houses that you didn't build, cities that you didn't build, wells that you didn't dig. I'm going to fill your house full of good things. According to Deuteronomy chapter 6, God says, I'm going to bless you. If you read it, he said, I'll bless you rising up, sitting down, going out and coming in. The Lord says, I'll bless your basket and your store. I'll bless your wife to be a fruitful vine, and your children will be like olive plants round about your table. God says, listen, the enemy will come at you one way and flee seven ways. Is there anybody? Is there anybody want to have a little church with me on this morning? God says, I will bless you. And that's exactly what the Lord did. And now we get to our text. Joshua is now coming to the land, and the Lord says, I'm going to give you victory. And there's going to be many cities that you conquer. Oh, yeah, you're going to conquer the land. You're going to conquer the inhabitants of the land. I'm going to bless you real good. But the Lord says, I got to have my portion. The Lord says, yes, I got to have my portion. And I want to take a few moments, not just to look at Jericho, but I want to look at this theme as it is sown and weaved throughout the Bible. There is a principle that the Lord always reserves to himself a portion. I don't care what it is. I don't care what he's doing. The Lord loves to bless his people. He loves to honor his people. He loves to daily load them with benefits. But the Lord always reserves for himself a portion. I want to take a look at the Lord's portion. Well, in our lesson, amen to God, and our foundational scripture on this morning, we find out that Jericho, being the first city, was the Lord's portion. And he told them, go into the city, burn it with fire. Amen. Destroy them. They're under the curse. Only save Rahab. And then he said, all that silver and gold and bronze and iron and precious stones, make sure you bring that to the house of the Lord. Why? Because that's my portion. The Lord's got to have his portion. Somebody type that in. The Lord's got to have his portion. Don't forget God. Don't forget God. He's going to bless you, but don't forget God. He's going to raise you up, but don't forget God. He's going to load you daily with benefits, but don't forget God. God's going to have his portion. We don't see this as this a new ideal or a new concept all the way back to the first day when God said, let there be, and there was. All the way back to the time where God put the sun in the sky and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. All the way back to the time that God created the fish of the sea and the fowl of the air and the creeping things and the animals. All the way back to the time that the Lord took 6 days to make all that he had made and looked at everything and said it was good. Oh, this is good and that's good and over there is good and over here is good. And even when he made man, he said it is very good. Not good that he's alone, but when he got that woman, let me tell you, you can change your life from not good to very good if you get the right woman in your life. I wish I had a witness, somebody. And so God had blessed everything. And then he says, I'm going to take the seventh day for myself. Come on, somebody. What is the first thing that the Lord reserved for himself? Somebody type it in. The Sabbath. The Sabbath is the Lord's portion. Let me read for you in Genesis chapter 2, verse number 2. On the seventh day, God completed his work, which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he had rested from all his work, which he had created and made. So here, amen, in the first move of God, we see that even concerning the days, in first day, the second day, the third, fourth, fifth, and sixth day, he's making things, he's creating things, he's bringing things together. He is letting, my God, the world begin to evolve and grow. But on the seventh day, he said, I'm going to reserve the seventh day for myself. And I want the people to remember the Sabbath day, that this is a holy day. This is my day. Don't want them to work on my day. Don't want them to labor on my day. Because the Lord always reserves to himself his portion. Exodus chapter 20, verse 8 says this. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work. You or your son or your daughter, your male servant, your female servant, or your livestock, or your sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Yes, people of God, the Sabbath was to be observed as a sign of the covenant between God and his people. It was a time to cease from work, a time to dedicate one's spiritual self to the Lord, a time of spiritual renewal, and a time of committing to God, a time to refocus. Now, you will see, as it was in Joshua chapter 6, when you took what was the Lord's portion, you were judged. If you keep on reading and get into chapter 7, you will find out there was a man that took something from Jericho. He took the Lord's portion and he got in trouble. His name was Achan. He died by stoning. He and his family, his wife and children, they dug up his tent and set him on fire and stoned them in the valley of Achor. The word Achor means trouble. Achan got in trouble because he took the Lord's portion. Not only that, but when you study the Sabbath, Those that are Bible readers understand that it was Judah that was sentenced to 70 years of Babylonian captivity because they failed to allow the ground to rest. They violated the Sabbath. They took the Lord's portion. And 10 times every 7 years, they were to let the ground rest. But 10 seasons of rest had passed. A total of 70 years went by, and they didn't allow the land to rest. Therefore, God kicked them out of the land. For how long? For 70 years down in Babylon. And Daniel was praying, and he gets a word from the Lord that the Lord, amen, the 70 years of judgment is over. And then, amen, Nehemiah comes back and begins to rebuild the walls. And Ezra comes back and begins to rebuild the temple. But it is because they violated the Sabbath or took the Lord's portion. My God, let's move a little forward. Look at Genesis chapter 2. Here God makes man and makes woman and puts them in the garden and said, y'all can have everything you want. Eat all the fruit. Eat all of it. He said, the fruit shall be your meat. Enjoy. You got the animals. You got everything. You got paradise. You got running rivers and waters and everything you need. But I have my portion. This is what the Lord said. The Lord said, amen, in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the knowledge or of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil ye shall not eat. For in the day that you eat, when you take my portion, you will surely die. Well, I told you, they got in trouble in Joshua chapter 6. They got in trouble with the Sabbath, and also Adam and Eve got in trouble with touching the unforbidden tree. Here it is, God reserves a portion. It doesn't matter if it's a day. It doesn't matter if it's a tree. It doesn't matter if it's the spoil from the first of the battle. God always reserves to himself a portion. In Exodus chapter 13, we see that God says, I want the firstborn. Look at this now. Exodus chapter 13, verse 2. He says, consecrate to me every firstborn male. The first offspring of every womb among the Israelites belongs to me, whether human or animal. It even picks it up and says it like this in Numbers chapter 3, verse 13. For all the firstborn are mine. When I struck down all the firstborn in Egypt, I set apart for myself. See, God's got a portion. I set apart for myself every firstborn in Israel, whether human or animal, they are to be mine. I am the Lord. So look at the Lord moving now. The Lord's got his portion in the firstborn. He killed all of the firstborns of the Egyptian, but he said, I'm going to reserve some for me. I'm all the firstborn of the womb, male, human, or animal. My God, the Lord says, I'm going to have my portion. Look with me at Exodus chapter 34 as we take a look at the first fruits. Here we see that the first fruits. He says, I want the first fruits. Look at Exodus chapter 34, verse 26. Here's a new idea that's introduced. He says, bring the best of the first fruits of your soil to the house of the Lord your God. Do not cook a young goat in its mother's milk. In Deuteronomy 26, verse 1, it says this. And it must be when you come into the land which the Lord your God is giving you for an inheritance, and you possess it and dwell in it, that you shall take from the first of all the produce, amen, of the ground which you shall bring from your land that the Lord your God has given you, and put it in a basket and go to the place where the Lord your God chooses to make his name abide. You shall go to the priest in office at that time and say to him, I profess this day to the Lord your God that I have come into the land which the Lord promised to our fathers to give us. The priest will take the basket out of your hand and set it down before the altar of the Lord your God. So here the instructions are given in Deuteronomy. Do yourself a favor, read the rest of that chapter. It'll blow your mind. But the people, he said, I'm going to bring you into the promised land, and you're going to start growing things. Hey, no more manna. It's not going to fall down. It's going to come up. The thing about the manna is everybody got the same thing. You gathered a lot, you had no over. You gathered a little, you had no lack. It was a system of equality. But when you come into the promised land, you're in a whole nother system. It's a system of seed sowing. If you want a lot, then you sow a lot. If you sow sparingly, you will reap sparingly. So you can determine your own future. In the promised land, he says, now when you come into the land and you start growing stuff, he said, take the best of what you grow and offer it to the Lord. Give me a first fruits offering. You're gonna eat for years. You and your family, y'all gonna be straight. But I want the first fruits, my God. Look at the Lord. I want the Sabbath. I want the first battle, the spoil of the first battle. I want the firstborn. I want the first fruits. And then this new concept, the best. There are two things that represent the Lord's portion. What? That which is first and that which is best. Come on, type it in. Somebody type it in, type it in. If you're in the room, I want you to look at the person sitting next to you and tell them God wants what's first and God wants what's best. Hallelujah. Yeah, he wants the first fruits. He wants the first of the womb. And then there's this thing called the tithe. What does it say here in Leviticus chapter 27, verse 30? Any tithe of the land, whether seed of the land or fruit of the tree, belongs to the Lord. It is holy to the Lord. If a man plans on redeeming some of his tithe, if you want to borrow some of your tithe, you shall add 1/5 to it. If you want to use the tithe, he says you're going to have to pay it back with interest. Because any tithe of herd or flock, all that passes under the counting staff, the tenth one shall be holy to the Lord. You count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That belongs to God. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. That belongs to God. Why? Because the Lord has a portion. There are a whole lot of people. You've been praying for God to bless you. But the question is, do you understand that everything that comes into your hand, there's a portion of it that belongs to God? He wants the first. He wants the best. He wants the tenth. He wants the Sabbath. He took the spoil of the first city, Jericho. He says, I want the firstborn. And then he says, I want the Levites. My God, the Levites, it blows my mind here. It blows my mind. In Numbers chapter 3, I don't know if you know, when he called Israel, he called them to be a nation of priests. And they were all brought to the foot of the mountain. But they said, no, we can't meet God face to face. We're not ready to sanctify ourselves and consecrate ourselves the way the Lord calls for us. So the Lord says, all right, I'm going to have a tribe. I'm going to have my portion. I can't have all 12 of them. I'm going to take the tribe of Levi. Look what he says. Verse number 11, Numbers chapter 3. The Lord spoke to Moses saying, I myself have taken the Levites from among the children of Israel instead of all the firstborn that openeth the womb among the children of Israel. Therefore, the Levites will be mine. Wow. And in Numbers, he said, I want to make sure y'all take care of the Levites. Take care of the minister. Take care of the priest. Take care of the prophet. Take care of the man or woman of God. Look what he says here in Numbers chapter 18, verse number 6 through 9. He says, I myself have taken your brothers, the Levites, from among the children of Israel. They are given to you as a gift from the Lord to perform the service of the tent of meeting. And you and your sons with you will attend to your priesthood for everything at the altar and within the veil. And you will serve. I have given your priesthood to you as a gift service. Wow. And the foreigner that comes near will be put to death. Don't let nobody mess with your man. Don't let nobody mess with your woman of God. The Lord spoke to Aaron, I have certainly given you the charge of the offerings made to me, all the hollow gifts of the children of Israel. to you and your sons have I given them as a portion, as an ordinance forever. This will be yours of the most holy thing, reserved from the fire. All of their offerings, all of their grain offerings, and all of their sin offerings, and all of their guilt offerings, which they render to me, will be most holy for you and for your sons. Look at verse number 21. He says it so plainly, I have given the children of Levi all the tithes in Israel for an inheritance. For their service, what's it for? For their service which they serve, even the service of the tent of the meeting. The Lord says, I have reserved the Levites and the tithe is mine. What are we going to do with the tithe? We're going to take care of the priest with the tithe. I am their portion. They don't have no inheritance in the land. They are mine, and I am their portion. So when the people brought their tithe, when the people brought their offering, he says, Aaron, you and your sons, all those who are Levites, those who are priests, this is how you're cared for. This is how you minister. And you do this for your service unto the Lord amongst the tent of the people. When I speak, I'm going to speak through them. When I prophesy, I'm going to prophesy through them. I'll bring healing. I'll bring counsel. I'll bring encouragement. I'll bring inspiration. I'll bring guidance. I'll bring my word through my men, through my women of God. And I want to make sure you understand that your giving is to sustain the priest forever. My God, are you hearing what I'm saying? I'm on third base now. Let me wrap it up. Look at this. Look at this list of things now. The Lord says the first of the spoil from Jericho, the Lord's portion. The Lord says the seventh day, the Sabbath, the Lord's portion. The Lord says the tree of knowledge there in the garden. Everything is yours, but I'm going to reserve for me a portion. What else? The firstborn, the Lord's portion. The first fruit, the Lord's portion. The tithe, the Lord's portion. The Levite, the Lord's portion. And then, according to the word of God, even the first begotten of the dead, Jesus Christ himself. You say, God, you want me to pay tithe? God says, I'm not going to ask you to do what I haven't done myself. What do you do, God? I gave my first and I gave my best. Look at what it says here in John chapter 20, verse 17. Jesus said to her, stop holding on to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. The King James says, touch me not, for I haven't ascended to my Father. But the literal translation of John 20 and 17, Jesus is telling Mary, stop holding on to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. What is he saying here? He's saying, y'all keep trying to hold on to me, but I am the Lord's portion. Yeah, you don't want to hold on to the Lord's portion. See, when you release what is the Lord's, then the Lord begins to bless you with even more. Jesus said, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. He said, but I'm not going to leave you comfortless. My God, I'm going to send you another comforter, and that is the Holy Ghost. Let me hear your war cry. My God, hallelujah. But you've got to release what is the Lord's portion. In Revelation chapter 1, verse number 4 and 5, he says, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness. Who is he? The firstborn from the dead. And the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. I'll conclude today by telling you that the Lord has a portion. And every time you see people try to take, touch, or mess with what the Lord says is mine. When they messed with the spoil of Jericho, they fell under the judgment of God. When they didn't keep the Sabbath, they fell under the judgment of God. When they robbed God of the tithe, they fell under the judgment of God. My God, when they spoke against the man of God, when they didn't honor the priest, the Levite, they fell under the judgment of God. Whether it was the firstborn, even the tree of knowledge of good and evil, when they touched what belonged to God, when they touched the Lord's portion, then they fell under the Lord's judgment. And even Jesus Christ himself, he was holy. He was the firstborn. He was the first fruits, the first begotten of the dead. He belonged to God. And he even told Mary, "Let me go, woman, because I belong to God." You got to release the Lord's portion. I conclude on this morning telling you that the Lord has a portion. He has always reserved a portion. And now to all of you who have been testifying that the Lord has been good to you, is there anybody, is there a word out here? Is there a testimony? Is there anybody that can wave their hand and say, "Yes, yes, sir, God has been good to me"? Is there anybody out here that can say, "God got me the job, God got me the house, God got me the car, clothes I'm wearing, amen, shoes on my feet"? Is there anybody out here that the Lord has protected and preserved from death? Has the Lord been good to you? You know, we talk about his goodness. We testify of his goodness. We always bragging and boasting on the grace of God, how he's forgiven us of sin. When all that blessing comes your way, always remember that the Lord got a portion. I prophesy that large sums of money are coming into the lives of the people of God. And you can't forget the Lord's portion. I prophesy raises and increases coming to the people of God. And you cannot forget the Lord's portion. Some of you, your children, your family, my God, he'll give you, as he said to his people, cities and houses that you didn't build, wells that you didn't dig. The Lord will elevate you and raise you up. But let's take a note from Joshua at Jericho. He said, "All right, you there's a lot of cities you're going to get, but this is my portion." There is always something reserved for the Lord. It's the Lord's portion. Come on and clap your hands for the word of the Lord. Come on, clap your hands. Praise God for his word. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. Give him praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I understand, Lord. You're going to bless me, but you've got a portion. You're going to increase me, but there is something that belongs to you. You're going to, my God, multiply your grace in my life, but you will have your portion. Thank you, Jesus. What a powerful word for us today. Amen. On this Super Seed Sunday. It's a time to give. It's a time to worship. It's a time to honor the Lord with our giving. On Wednesday night, we talked through it, amen to God, that our preparation, and that is preparing a special seed to worship the Lord, amen, that $500 seed, that $1,000 seed, it takes preparation. It takes strategy. It takes arranging. It takes sacrifice. It takes dedication. David said, I set my affection to the house of God, to that which is holy. And our purpose, David said, I prepared in a time of trouble. You know, a lot of people are always making excuses about why they can't do this, why they can't do that. David had giant trouble. He had wife trouble. He had in-law trouble. He had Philistine trouble. My God, he had help folk that won't help you back trouble. He had in debt, distress, and discontented trouble. He even had trouble with his own flesh. But David said, in the midst of my trouble, I prepared. I want the saints of God on today, on this special Super Seed Sunday, to take that attitude that David had, that in the midst of your trouble, you've prepared the Lord's portion. We are going to worship the Lord today in a special way. I did not want to have this as our focus on last Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. Let it be about Jesus and his resurrection. But this Sunday, we are going to make sure that our focus is on God, and we will worship him through our sacrificial giving. It's not something that we do every week. It's not something that we do unless the Holy Spirit prompts us in a very special way. But this is a planned time of worshiping God. And let us proceed with the message of the Lord's portion in our mind, that since the beginning, whether the Sabbath, the tree, the firstborn, the first fruits, the tithe, the Levites, the first fruits, my God, even the first spoil of the city of Jericho, or the first begotten of the dead, Jesus Christ himself being God's tithe, his first, his best, that belongs to the Lord. My God, what a word, what a word, what a word. And I pray that you are inspired, as I have instructed you, to prepare a special time of worship. Yes, we are going to pray and in the traditional sense, open the doors of the church, giving your life to Jesus Christ is the most important thing, not giving $500, not giving $1,000, but repenting of your sins. That's the most important thing. Let me tell you, he will never get your pocketbook, your purse, your wallet, your money, unless he has your heart. But when he gets your heart, you understand that everything that you have belongs to God. And isn't it something that he doesn't ask for everything? Isn't it something that you can't give God anything because he owns everything? But the Lord says, no, I'm gonna bless you, but just make sure that you remember my portion. Oh, I can pay your house off. Just remember my portion. I can pay your automobile off. I can cause you to live debt-free. Just remember my portion. A raise is a small thing. That's a small thing for me. I can heal your body. I can save your loved ones. It's a small thing. Just remember my portion. And when you go down the line, every time they fooled with the Lord's portion, they got in trouble with God. I want to challenge you today to honor the Lord in this special time of worship. It's our Supersede Sunday. In this moment, as we prepare to conclude our service today, I want to thank God for all of those that came, amen, to the Silver Spot Theater. Here we are again, having a good time in the name of the Lord, and those that have tuned in all over this country, to God be the glory. It is a time of blessing. It is a time of prosperity. It is a time of the Lord's favor. But what a powerful word for us today about the Lord's portion. With that, I want all the saints to honor the Lord as we do every week, bi-weekly, once a month, however God has honored you. We bring the tithe. The tenth is holy unto the Lord. That belongs to God. That's his regular portion. But on today, we have prepared. We have set aside. We've strategically asked God's people to stretch out and give him the worship of sacrifice, sacrificial giving, sacrificial giving. You know, Samuel was the Lord's first. He was the firstborn of Hannah, and she offered him to the Lord. My God, the first. David represents the best. He is given unto the Lord. And you just go through the whole scriptures, and you will see again and again and again, the Lord had a portion. How about the mother of Moses and the father of Moses? They placed their baby. They released him unto the Lord. And look what the Lord did. As you take what is special, Abraham has Isaac, his physical firstborn from Sarah, is offered unto the Lord. The Lord wants what's first. The Lord wants what's best. It's his portion. So today, make the arrangements. Step out on faith. Stretch. Come on, people of God, stretch. Stretch. And worship the Lord in this supersede giving. Oh, praise God. Praise God. All right. First Sunday has been off the chain. Every first Sunday, we will be in the space, in this space. This space has been working for us. Amen. Last Sunday, today, amen. We're blessed. And so once again, 30 days from now, first Sunday, amen, of, I guess it's May now, amen, we will be right here at the Silver Spot, amen, cinema at 10 o'clock is our service time, but you want to get here at 9:30, and we'll have a special presentation in the Word of God, special ministry for you. And then even after our time of ministry in the Word and a time of fellowship, we have something special for the families, amen, in the form of a movie presentation that you are going to be blessed, amen, with in just a few moments from now. For those who are online, certainly we're not at liberty to stream those themes out. And so this is a blessing for those who are in the room. Thank God for that. But for those of you all that are online, YouTube, I want you to make sure that you get the Lord's portion today. Let's get it today. Let's remember the words of King David, who said, I prepared in the time of trouble. Let's not give the Lord excuses about why this and why that. You know what? I said something very powerful this week, and that is trouble doesn't exempt you from being a mother. Trouble doesn't stop you from being responsible. Trouble doesn't put a hold on life for you to do what you got to do. Mm-mm. David says trouble is a part of life. Trouble, hardship, hard times, different things that come, unexpected things, that's a part of life. You just got to be so committed to God that even in your time of trouble, you prepare. You make sure the Lord is first. You honor him and watch what the Lord does in your life. Let's give the Lord his portion today. I love you, love you, love you. It has been wonderful ministering to you today. Certainly, we want you to join us for our daily bread. Join us for our morning prayer. Join us for our noon, our evening sacrifice. Amen to God. All the ministry that we're putting out, we want you to be blessed by it, strengthened by it. We are, amen, believers who are being discipled through daily ministry. And certainly, we are watching, amen, strong believers, amen, minister from their location. Mature believers are ministering from their location. And we're raising up a strong people who know God and expand his kingdom, serve his purpose. To God be the glory. All right, people of God, I love you, love you, love you. Amen. Share the love of Jesus Christ all this week. And now let me pray God's blessing on you. But my instructions to you are to navigate on the screen. And there are some that say, well, Bishop, I haven't gotten real fluent in the digital giving yet. Well, you can call the church office. Amen. Call your pastor, Lenora. She'll help guide you, or she'll even take your information over the phone. But we want everybody today to worship the Lord in a special sacrificial giving. Yes, we've asked every member to sow the $500 seed, but we are challenging our leaders and those who the Holy Spirit will speak to go beyond the $500 and release the $1,000 seed. There are some that the Holy Spirit will speak to and say, you know what? I put you in a position to sow even beyond the $1,000. You obey me. Step out in faith and stretch and release your special gift to the Lord. It is the Lord's portion. Father, I thank you now for the Spirit of the Lord that is upon us. Thank you for the powerful word that has gone forth on today. Now smile upon your people and give us favor. Let this week be blessed. And then I ask a special blessing on all those who are giving, all those who are sowing, all those who are stepping out in faith and stretching to honor you with this special sacrificial supersede. In Jesus' name, we pray that you'll continue to draw the lost, restore the backslider, lift up the bowed down head, and touch all those who are feeble, who are sick, who have been attacked by the enemy. Let your grace, let your presence, Let your healing power be upon them now. Smile upon us and give us your favor is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Until next time, peace to the family.
If you believe in the power of prayer, join us at 8 a.m. every morning, Monday through Friday, on our prayer line, 712-775-8968. The access code is 304-282. Join Bishop Clark Monday through Fridays at 9 a.m. for our daily bread. It's refreshing, it's enlightening, and it's empowering. We'll see you there. Hello, partners, members, and friends. It's time to worship the Lord through our giving. The scripture commands us to honor the Lord with 10%, which is our tithe, and He will send His blessing. And as we honor the Lord with an offering, the Lord will allow men to give unto us good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. So let's be obedient and honor the Lord now.
There are several ways to support the Body of Christ Assembly through your giving. Through our Cash App, $BOCACHURCH. You can mail in your donation to BACA at 20900 Miles Parkway, Warrensville Heights, Ohio, 44128. Or you can call in your donation to 216-475-6327. Remember, every seed brings forth a harvest. Begin your gifting today.